Where's the settings?
No, maybe that's not Monty.
Oh, the mic works. You can see it.
Hi. Hello?
Is that to the right mic?
That's what I don't know.
We got the mic.
Where is the setting?
Wait. Can you go like this?
Oh, there we go. Microphone.
Probably.
I think so. We're just trying to make sure that, because like, we can't figure out where the camera. Yeah, where's the settings for that?
Hello. Should I just sit at this table here too and put up chairs for all of us?
For what?
Like, are you going to stand up here the whole time?
No. I'm just getting it set, so yeah. It's just going.
But I'm just saying, do you want me to sit at this table? I noticed that table there is all reserved.
I don't know yet.
Okay. All right.
Just give me a second. Just trying to see if everything's working.
Thank you, Robert.
Why is there cards? It's not using the webcam audio. What kind of audio is it using?
Maybe the... Oh. It's working. Sounds pretty good. I think it's picking up the right mic.
Maybe this bar is just screwed up.
Yeah. Yeah, it's picking up everything right. Okay.
Okay.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the live stream. Let's check in for audio, video. If anybody can hear me and see me, give me a thumbs up.
Got it now?
I was looking at this, right?
Oh, yeah. Vaguely.
Yeah, vaguely, yeah.
Where's Monty?
Monty's not here. Monty's in the hospital. They're live streaming this for Monty. Yeah. Oh. Monty's gonna be there. He's doing quite well. His brother over there, that's who there is the brother that I was mentioned with, Ron, and he's not going to be here. He's the two brothers. I don't know all the details. He's falling. Yeah, he was like,
This whole thing has disrupted everything and everybody.
Hope you change it. Change your life.
Yeah. I don't want to give you an elbow. I'd rather give you a hug. I'm a shake.
Yeah, that's the thing. So did you know
Jim? Oh. Oh, well, you
from playing music.
And what have you?
Okay.
Yeah. We always enjoyed Jim coming up and spent time with Jim.
Great to see you. And you wouldn't know where we live. No, it's not there anymore, but it's a very easy landmark because when you see a tower, one of the pillars by the tower is a basement. And we didn't have a basement, we had a dugout, but one of those pillars is right in where our house would have been. Yeah, on the hill, like up near the fire pond. Okay, where the fire pond is, there's an actual
everything was still there. All the time on Halloween. And you know what? Nobody ever found out exactly who he was.
Well,
we call them Halloween ghosts.
We had
them
back then. They like to move the
outhouse
most days.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we used to do that too.
I don't leave.
No problem, Robert.
This is more for the closer family. I'm going to go to the city.
To announce that we are live streaming this, so and it's in the back there. If anybody wants to say hi, wherever there are people watching, just go up to the computer there and we'll record you. Everybody can see you. So, does anyone want to go say hi or people at home? Go ahead.
Do you remember? It's so good.
Every clock in the building is
Well, 10 minutes. No, I know this one's right on.
And what do you got?
12 hours. It's 6. It's 12. You're right on. 12 minutes.
I can never get rid of the plugging up.
I've got the same problem.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I can go. I'm going to announce that right now.
People here, I haven't recognized you because
Oh, for sure, yeah, that's fully understandable, Robert.
100% understandable, Robert. We must have some pictures at home, maybe, with the baskets or whatever in general in town. No, no, we should have them somewhere.
I'm going to go to the next one. I'm going to go to the next one.
Apparently, if you got it set up there, if you're live streaming to Jan or to Monty and the other brother, apparently, and anybody else that's watching, it's live streaming. So, yeah, like I was blown away when Robert said that Monty was in the background. No.
Say hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Dietrich.
Hi, Dietrich.
Say hi, Uncle Monty.
Hi, Uncle Monty.
Hey, Cousin Lori. Glad you guys can join us from at least here. Love you.
I have problems with it sometimes too. Monty's even older than I am. I mean, I'm a year and a half older than Jimmy. And Monty, I think, is about 4 years older than me. See, like I say, Jimmy, I'm pointing to the picture up there. Jimmy, he was basically about a year. I am basically about a year older than Jimmy. So, and I know Monty, but I think. Yeah, Richard, I think was a year and a half old. So, I mean, John, I'm a little older than John. And Doug. Maybe with the rain, the road. Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Oh, really? I know that. But to have your attention,
Wow.
Okay, James.
Thank you.
We're just waiting on one to arrive.
Yes, I'll be sorry. I'll tell you what you want. I know that's all fine. Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. That's the reason why.
I'm Father in heaven, we pray today for the Velo family. for Susan and the children and the grandchildren, for brothers. And Lord, we pray that your comfort and your strength would be their portion. God, it is so difficult and tough when we lose a loved one. And it doesn't matter whether it's sudden or whether we have a lingering death, but Lord, it is difficult in our loss. Lord, we may look and say that they've gone to a better place without pain, but our grief is just the same nonetheless. And Father, we pray that you just comfort them and strengthen them. And we pray today for Monty and Ron that are not with us for physical reasons, and Monty in the hospital. Father, we just pray that you touch their physical bodies in the name of Jesus. Lord, you are our great source and our great healing power. Lord, just minister your life in their bodies, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I have a few thoughts about Jim, and not many. Jim was much, much older than us. Like we were kids, and he was years old. So when your kid's 3 years, it's much, much older. And so I remember a number of things about Jim. I remember Jim was pretty kind-hearted and pretty level, you know. But I do remember one instance, and I remember when how two young whippersnapper brothers and a friend from across the street can really irritate somebody. And I don't know if Doug remembers it the way I do. I'll put in my own details because it's my story. And but I remember that Mr. and Mrs. Velo were not at home. They had gone, I think, to the sea, or maybe they were out of the cabin at Long Lake, but I know that there were the three boys that were home, Doug, Ron, and Jim. And Jim, at the time, was working for San Antonio Gold. And Jim had to get up in the morning to go work. And they introduced me to a game that I never played and have probably never played since. It's called Revolver. And we started playing, in the early part of the evening. And about 1 o'clock, Jim came out of the room. And he started playing with us, by the way, but he had to go to sleep because he had an early shift, apparently, which didn't mean anything to us, right? And we played. And Jim got up and said, "You guys got to keep it down." Well, we did, until somebody either cheated or whatever. And then the noise went out. And so Jim went to work somewhat tired in the morning, and very grumpy. I don't even understand that, because we had a lot of fun. And I certainly don't understand what Jim's problem was. And then I have a number of sisters, I have five of them. And I have one sister who may be watching, but and so I'll try and keep the story true. Yeah, so she came and she went to school in the set for only 6 months. But this just kind of shows the kindness and stuff. And I was over at Susan's the other night. And Susan pulled out an album and I thumbed through it. And she said, "Take it home with you." And I said, "No, I can't take it home." She said, "Just take it home." So I put it down and didn't finish looking at it. And I got home and I'm looking at these pictures. And there's my sister. She's sitting on Jim's lap, but only because there's a whole group of people in that picture, and that was where we get them all together, all to sit on each other's lap and stuff. But that story, sometimes teenagers and so on can be so unkind, but that's the set crew. They were a nice bunch of people, And so this city girl came there, didn't know anybody, and apparently, if you look at the picture, you see her, she walked into the door expecting to visit, and here's the whole crowd from the school, and Jim was a big part of that, and so that's another memory. Now, I didn't know Jim much over the years, because we left the set, and my family moved to Swan River, and then, when my wife and I got married, we were looking for an apartment. And we went to somebody's apartment, and who answered the door? Jim Beal. And so we rented our second apartment, actually, from Jim. And one of the things I know about, I don't know if he delves into it as much as the rest of them, but the Beal family, they're into archiving, like the pictures and collecting pictures. And I remember Ron had told me one time, after they had a fire, when they lived across the street from us, they had a fire, and the house burned to the ground, and they lost all the pictures, they lost all the memorabilia and stuff. And Mr. Vilo went around town taking pictures of everybody as a memory, because he's trying to restore some of the memories, even though they weren't in the situation. But he wanted pictures of all the people that that remember from the set. And then, you know, this Facebook thing has kind of reintroduced people. And so when Jim became my friend on Facebook, I started getting pictures from Jim. And, you know, because I have no pictures of the set. And now I have a whole archive of them from people that have sent me pictures. And then and I noticed looking through, again, this album that Jim had purloined some of the pictures out of my Facebook page and so on. Especially, I have an old an album, a yearbook from San Antonio School. And he called me and he says, "Where did you get that?" Because he had one, but lost in the fire. And so I had put it all up on Facebook, and so he called me. So that's my thoughts about Jim, and we just, you know, had. I have such fond memories of him, even though I didn't hang around with him, but I did hang around with his brothers. So at this time, I have a poem, and it's called "To Those I Loved and Those Who Love Me." And it was contributed by Jim's good friend, Cliff Murphy. So I want to read this poem for you. "To those I loved and to those who loved me. When I am gone, release me, let me go. I have so many things to see and do. You mustn't tie yourself to me with tears. Be happy that we have these precious years. I gave to you my love. You can only guess how much you gave to me in happiness. I thank you for the love you each have shown, but now it's time I travel on alone. So grieve a while for me, if grieve you must, then let your grief be comforted by trust. It's only for a while that we must part, so bless the memories within your heart. I won't be far away, for life goes on, so if you need me, call and I will come. Though you can't see me or touch me, I'll be near. And if you listen with your heart, you'll hear all of my love around you, soft and clear. And then, when you must come this way alone, I'll greet you with a smile and say, well." What a precious thing. This time Jason is going to come, and as I said, we're going to play some recorded music, and this time we're going to play the Jim Reeves version of this group.
Whispers were comforting words. Wait till the darkness is over. Wait till the tempest is done. For the sunshine to fall and the darkness is gone.
On behalf of my family, we would like to thank everyone who is present today and for those of you who have sent their condolences. We have received countless phone calls, emails, messages, flowers, meals, visits, thoughts, and prayers. We have been both comforted during this difficult time and have been a reminder of the impact that God has had on so many.
Before I start on what I got prepared, a couple of comments on what Robert mentioned. The night we played Rimoli, if you know how you play Rimoli, there's a spinning wheel in there, and you throw a ball in there, and you spin it until it stops on the right card or whatever. We played that till what I gathered is what the sun was coming up. Mm-hmm. And to say Jim was irritated is an understatement. He was very mad. He was very happy. And the other one is Jim was very fortunate if Robert's sister sat on his left, because I think every guy was looking for that opportunity. A little bit about Jim's family history here. Jim was born April 13, 1947, in Bessette. Jim was the middle child of five boys, and he was very lucky. Jim attended San Antonio School until he finished grade 8. Then he went on to Selkirk and attended the Selkirk Comprehensive High School, completed grade 11 in 1966. In 1969, Jim married Sandra Fulton. Along came Michelle, Jesse, and Jason. In 1985, Jim and Susan were married. Along came Holly and Richard. When Jim and Susan were married, Jim also became a stepfather to Laura and Melanie. Then came along 11 grandchildren, one great-granddaughter. When they had family gatherings, they had a house full, which was something that Jim really enjoyed.
We are here today not to mourn, but to celebrate the life, to honor and remember my father, James, to be healed. I know my many of the disabilities. He has impacted and enriched our lives, not only as a husband, brother, father, grandpa, great grandpa, uncle and cousin, friend and neighbor. We have heard many that he's always been there to lend a hand. He's the best diesel mechanic that would jump at a hat to lend a trucker a hand, and the master of ceremonies that always kept the dance floor alive. The amount of people who have come to pay their last respects is only a testament to the lives he has personally touched.
Jim was a very likable person, always with a smile, you remember? Over the years, he made many close friendships that lasted a lifetime. Some that kept close contact with are, and I think some of you are here, I'm going to name a bunch. Tiff, Gordy, Don, Ryan, Ken, Mark, Burl and Alan, Barb, Dave, Dean, Richard, Gerald, Joey, Danny, Teddy, Al, Sam and Norm, Laurie, Jay and Laurie, Adam, Martin, Linda and Gary, Edie and Rick, and many, many others. And I'm hoping some of them that I'm naming off are here, but there's no tomorrow.
Dad was full of life. He loved having a good time and showed us that life should be fun. His sense of humor, intelligence, and love of music brought him a successful career and brought joy to so many. Dad's talent for being an entertainer astonished me. Not only carrying loads of heavy equipment, but the way that he could read and handle a crowd was a gift in itself. Anyone could ask him a song, say a line, or hum a bar, and he knew the song, the artist, the year it was written, and the background to the song. Unfortunately for radio stations, he won hundreds of prizes for the extensive knowledge of his music. He played for countless events, sometimes three or four events a weekend, for a magnitude of people all across Manitoba. When I asked him what his favorite gigs were, he told me the ones with the good food. Dad loved and always appreciated the good meals shared during his events.
George Sunday, 1967, Jim and I traveled to Brandon, Ontario to visit our brother Bill. Jim was having trouble with his car discharging. He took it to a garage in Kenora, they put on a new generator, and off he went heading for the set. Driving in the evening, the car lights kept getting dimmer and dimmer, finally stalling on the highway near the turnoff to West Hawk Lake. We walked to West Hawk Lake that night and stayed in the motel, which Jim paid for, reluctantly. Jim called the same garage and they sent out a mechanic who met at the car. He quickly said, two wires were reversed. We were quickly on our way. This may be the day Jim decided to become a mechanic. No one would ever do that to him again. So approximately 1970, Jim starts a four-year apprenticeship at Virginia College to become a diesel mechanic. He became a top-notch, well-respected mechanic, working for large trucking companies. He was very dedicated to his employer and to the truckers who he enjoyed many friendships with. He was liked by all his co-workers and truckers. Jim never took breaks other than a lunch break. Never did. Many times, he was called in to work evenings and nights. He always went in off hours to get the trucks on the road. He knew how important it was to get that freight moving. When Jim retired in January 2009, he was showered with many nice gifts, which he thoroughly enjoyed.
He was a jack of all trades. Not only was he a fantastic diesel mechanic, but he could fix anything, from big rigs to my little dolls that he would patiently fix numerous times. There was always a project on the go. Dad gave freely of his time to many organizations, including the Selkirk Parade, the MS Walkathon in Lacabani, and countless fundraising events that I can't even remember them all. He even volunteered fighting fires in the 70s in and around Set, Manitoba. He also took up brewing in the 70s, making his own beer. His root beer was like no other, 100% better than A&W. One night, though, must have been a warm one, because we were awoken to the sounds of gun pops and shattering glass. All Dad's brew, which had been brewing under his bed, on shag carpet, I might add, exploded. I think that's the night that I learned all the swear words.
During the March 1966 snowstorm, Jim was living in Selkirk. Jim and Ken Allen, who was sitting back there, decided to do some shopping in Winnipeg. He settled walking and hitchhiking to the next city. Not much traffic, so I think it was a lot of walking by everybody else. When they arrived in Winnipeg, all the stores were closed. They promptly turned around and started walking and hitchhiking back to Selkirk. It was not a bright idea for that day, but they should have got their fresh air and exercise.
I admire my dad so many different levels. Sorry. I admire my dad on so many different levels. He guided me and he showed me how to be stronger than independent. And always look for the best deal. He would not let me buy my first car until I knew how to change a tire, change the oil, the battery, and general operation of the vehicle. My cherished moments are the countless hours fishing and showing me survival skills at our cottage in the set. And when I joined the track and field team in high school. Dad encouraged me not only to work on the short track, but long distance. Most dads sat on the sidelines, not my dad. He made me practice by running alongside me. 5 miles up Selkirk and down Manitoba, me keeping up, trying to keep up with his strides. Music has always been in our household. Dad was quite a good dancer. He was my first dance partner, showing me all the dance moves, standing on his feet. So now, when music comes on, I'm like a pied piper. The song comes on, my feet just start moving.
One Christmas, when Jim was working in Merritt, BC, he came home for the holidays. At that time, Jim was driving a 1950 DeSoto. I think he paid about $50 for it. But it was actually a pretty nice car. On his return trip to Merritt, on the Ball Prairie, Jim's car quit on. He managed to pull it over the side of the highway. He was so frustrated, he took the license plates off the car, grabbed his suitcase, and hitchhiked the rest of the way to Merritt. Another reason he may have decided to become a mechanic.
As kids, we spent much time with our father at Grad Sales, flea markets, and especially the Red River Bookstore, where he would pick up all the throwouts. He and his buddy Harold Basketball would ship packages over to seize the shoulders of soldiers with parcels that he got. Of course, throwing in a hustler and a good playboy. Sunday morning pitch adventures, which I still do today, was looking for our weekly allowance, but the garbage runs were my most fun. It was like a treasure hunt. Many occasions we would come home with more than what we took. Dad really knew how to recycle. I know Dad is looking down right now on this and us. But I truly believe he knows how much he would really love. He would have loved all this attention. For the past week, probably the first time ever, all of the kids got along to organize this, to honor him.
In 1963, Jim got his driver's license. He was 16, freedom. The day he received it in the mail, back then you did your testament, you get your license in the mail, he asked Dad if he could borrow the car for him and three buddies to go to Wallace Lake. I overheard them talking, and one of them said, "I will get the beer." Well, this was my chance. If you do not take me along, I will tell Dad. It's like this beer was more important than having a little brother along, so they reluctantly took me along. It was dark. Remember, Jim just got his license, so not much experience. It was dark and driving along a narrow piece of road along Bennett Lake. Jim met a car. Well, the inexperienced Jim sideswiped the oncoming car. Immediately, the beer went out the back window into the ditch. The other driver walks up to Jim's window, and it's Walter Harsh, the local butcher. They exchange particulars, and Walter leaves, heading towards the set. The four buddies dive into the ditch. We heard the dumpster diving while this was ditch diving, looking for the beer. I think they did salvage some, because it was all bottles back then. So I was sworn to secrecy. That was 58 years ago when Jim got his license. I think I did pretty good until today.
Grandpa was so proud of his grandchildren. He may have not said it directly, but when bumping into his friends, they would tell me of how he would boast about them. The countless hours he spent doing horseback rides, walks to check the garden, check the chickens, watching hockey games and bomber games, and of course, the grand sale of Jim. And don't forget sharing the ice cream with Grandpa. Grandpa really loved his ice cream. I hope that not only do you remember him for the fantastic feats and Christmas at Thanksgiving, and for being able to take any piece of meat and make it into a gourmet meal, but the noises he made. I can only make a few. It's my favorite. Someone whispered in my ear, they will always remember him for the rattling of his teeth after dinner. I giggle now because I'm so immune to the noise. I thought that was normal growing up. He loved all of his grandchildren in his and their own unique ways.
When Jim was courting Sandy, Sandy made some cookies, which she wanted Jim to try. For some reason, Jim declined. Maybe they didn't look very good, I don't know. Sandy was very insistent and finally tried to push one into Jim's mouth. This is when she found out Jim had a partial plate. I'm not sure if he ever did eat the cookie. Another story that goes kind of like the same thing. Jim and Canada all together, they hung out quite a bit together when they were young. Living in soccer, decided to go swimming, Sherbrooke Pool, Winnipeg. Again, they hitchhiked to Winnipeg, which was actually a regular mode of transportation back then. It was the thumb. They were both good swimmers, having grown up in Rice Lake. Jim decided to dive off one of the higher diving boards. When Jim came up, he was coughing, sputtering, and lots more coughing. His partial plate was halfway down his throat. He managed to cough them out and put them back in the rightful place. The moral of the story is, you need to know when to keep your mouth shut.
When Susan came into the picture, I must admit, being very young and not knowledgeable, we did not get along. But over the years, I've come to appreciate and see why my dad adored and loved her so. She has brought him years of joy, and he's Dad, and she is Dad's sweetheart. Their tireless devotion and dedication to him gives a testament of how a couple should stand together. Through every achievement and failings, they have always been by each other's side. The vows started off with a gamble in Vegas. Plays out to be more than two hands full of a royal flesh, the hearts of the family that they raised. Sorry.
Only one rehearsal.
Okay. Upon reflecting what we said about my dad, when you hear the name Jim Velo, what words immediately come to mind? I will share with you mine. He was a hard worker, strong, humorous, comical, caring, storyteller, master toolman, and diesel mechanic, and a talented singer, and a master of ceremonies, as well as a good friend. Over the past couple of days, people have told me some of the stories, quite often the same thing. I've been hearing, I will remember your dad because he shared something. Whether it be a tidbit, a record, a tool, a story, or just his time, he was a simple man who did not desire earthly goods, but to bring joy to others with his music. Let's take a moment and shift our thoughts from how much we will miss him to the one of happy and fun and comical times that we shared with him. I have just one poem to end it off. His journey has just begun. Don't think of him as gone away. His journey just begun. Life holds so many facets. This earth is only one. Just think of him as resting in the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days or years. Think how he must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of him as living in our hearts of those he's touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and he was loved so much. Written by E. Brennan.
Thank you.
Rest in peace, Jim.
Rest in peace, Dad.
Jesus, I've wasted it so heavily.
help me, Jesus. I know what I am. Now that I know that I'm needed, you so help me, Jesus. My soul's in your hands. Lord, help me, Jesus. I'm wasted in soul. Help me, Jesus. I know what I am. Now that I know that I'm needed, you so help me, Jesus. My soul's in your hands. Jesus, my soul's in your hands.
James chapter 4 and verse 14 says, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. The Bible describes this time, this morsel of time that you get to live. It's like a vapor. And living in Canada, we all know it's like the middle of winter. You one exhale and vapor goes and just disappears like that. That's what the Bible likens life to in its longevity. I've heard this expression so much because of the friends of the company, you've heard this expression. It says, I knew I was going to get old. I just didn't think it happened so soon. And so that's what happens. We get old, life past us, and we pass away. But there's people who look at life. I read a quote that said, life is an unpleasant interlude of nothingness. There's another one that says, there's a song that said, life is what you do waiting on God. But a different perspective on life. Life is given to us by God. In the very beginning, the Bible says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So we have life as a gift of God. And Jesus talked about another kind of life. He talked about an abundant life. He says a thief comes to steal and to kill and destroy. But he says, I come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. And I think when we think of abundance in life, I think our minds go to all the baubles and the beats, the gadgets, the trinkets, the things that we have, the possessions and so on. And that's the abundance. But in spiritual matters, God's indifferent about all those things. I know people that have absolutely nothing and are the richest people inside. We know those that just live for money and they're not very wealthy at all. They're actually poor. But there's an abundant life that is in Christ Jesus. I think of a conversation I had not that long ago with someone from so don't let any of your minds go. We just shared a thought about a certain teacher, and he said, I hate him. I'm thinking, this is 55 years later. How can you possibly hate somebody? You have no reason to hate him. You didn't encounter his wrath the way I did. And I'm thinking, and yet, I was at a union with him, and we sat And then we joked about those old days because, I mean, you ought not to carry that kind of unforgiveness. And I think in the poverty of spirit, somebody said that having unforgiveness is allowing someone to live rent-free in your mind. You know, and that's the opposite of the abundant life that Jesus brings. Jesus showed us that abundant life. He was on the cross. And he looked down at the people that were putting him on the cross, that were putting him to death, and he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's abundant life. Abundant life is what's happening on the inside. That's the kind of life that you get from Jesus. That's spiritual life. My wife and I used to sing a song periodically, and I'm not going to sing it for you, but I am going to read the words. It goes like this. If I could count all the tears that have fallen, it would seem like an ocean to me. And if my heart were a window you could look through, oh, the pain and the scars you would see. But that abundant life that I'm talking about carries with it a hope. It goes, and the chorus says, tears will never stain the streets of that city. No wreath of death on my mansion door. Teardrops aren't welcome beyond the gates of glory. For the heart will never break anymore. I have questioned the loss of a loved one. Oh, that grave seems so final and cold, but we'll meet again where death has no victory, in a land where we'll never go. That's abundant life, the hope of life in Christ. Then Jesus, when he's standing there, he looked at all the paupers, the common folk, not the people, all the rich. And he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. That's my life. Knowing that Christ is interested in what's going on. Jesus talks about life in three things. The life that you prove, the abundant life that comes from knowing God, and eternal life that comes from the heart from this life. We enter into a life that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Let's pray. Father, again, I pray that the people can. I pray especially for Susan. God, a tremendous loss, a companion, a comfort, a confident. Father, I just pray that you just overwhelm your presence and comfort. I pray, Lord, that the calls and the messages of compassion to her would not cease through this time. But Father, I pray that the support bread will just continue to flood toward her in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for the children. Lord, it is so difficult at any age to lose your parents. Lord, the parents, they are of whom we are substance. Lord, they are the ones that we have taken our problems to the military. When we were little children, right up until we're grandparents ourselves. Father, I just pray for the children, I pray for the children. Lord, that you would just minister the word of strength to them. In Jesus' name. So, I have a benediction. Also, Numbers. Lord, bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And I want to remind you to stay and share memories of Jim. There's going to be a light lunch served shortly. And also there's open mic. We're not supposed to hug. Some expressions of affection are being restricted and so on. But you can come to the mic and give your condolences and give a memory of a story and anecdotes about Jim's life, or Jim's influence on your life. And hang around because Jason has prepared a video and we'd like you to watch it. So, do you want me to pray for lunch right now? Is that what we're doing? Okay. Loving Father, we thank you for your provision. We thank you, Lord, that you make a way, and Lord, we have an abundance in this environment that we live in. And Father, I just pray that you bless the food that we're about to receive with us, our fellowship here in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm going to go to the next one. You guys How about you put it down and it'll be right here when you come back? Okay. 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 Well, I work on all types of things.
Nothing, can you
hear me? No. No. I got another quick story about Jim. Jim used to deliver newspapers in Cassette. And he had a fairly large tape route, about 50 newspapers, which was large for the town of Cassette. One year, the Free Press was offering for every new customer you got, they put your name in a draw for a trip to the Calgary Stampede. And Jim really wanted to go to the Calgary Stampede. So he kept ordering more newspapers and more newspapers all the time. And he did win. He won the trip to the Calgary Stampede, but the bush by our place was bright full of newspapers. They all ended up in the bush.
I'm going to go to the next one. I'm Yeah, I'm Central Airport.
I think it's I'm What was the name? Him and I have had a lot of
back to. We all have a frozen life to play. And I'll play a great one someday. Someday my day will come. I'll hold true love right in my hand. I'll touch the pretty brown bones in. My cup will overflow. Someday my day will come. I'll watch my ship as it comes in. My castles won't be made of sand. Someday the day will come. I'll hold true love right in my hand. Someday my day will come.
Thanks, guys.
Tell me about the jewels of the red so tired and feels this world gone crazy. Take me back to yesterday, put a line between your hands. Didn't seem so easy. Lovers really fall in love to stay. Stand beside each other on the way. Promise really something people can't come to something they would say. Families really bow their heads to pray. Daddy's really never go away. Oh, I'm afraid. Oh, tell me about the good old days. Everything has changed for the better. We call the progress. Just don't be rich. Grandma. Let's wander back to the bed. Then paint me a picture. Lovers really fall in love to stay. Stand beside each other on the face. Promise really something people will say. Not just something they will say. Then forget. Families really bow their heads to pray. Daddy's really never go away. Oh, 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 grandma, tell me about the good old days. Oh, 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 grandma, tell me about the good old days. Thank you.
real good looking man.
Oh boy, you got me freaking dirty. You make me have a good one. Jimmy, play your guitar. Oh God.
Hey, hi, Doug.
Hi, Doug. I see you every day playing cards at the table. Hey, Abe. Party in the air, do we?
Yeah.
Because he rolls around us. Three better. Yeah. Richard, we need you at the hospital here. Can you tell him where we do? Hi, love. Gonna be left a lot longer than me. I got one foot in the floor and the other one on. Hey, Holly, did you sell your house? Yeah. No, that's good. This is for Dad. I'm thinking about all of you kids. I have been trapped. Please come and see us. I'm in Loomwood. And Jason and Jesse. Make sure you do. And I spent a good time together. I thought I'd see Jason running up and down the halls here. Well, they'll think that she had me.
Put your tape for me, so I sent her a tape.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, everyone, we're going to end the live stream here. Thanks for tuning in.